Hello, and welcome to the 2022 Virginia Festival of the Book, featuring Bodies in Space and Time, Identity in Sci-Fi and Speculative Fiction. I'm Sarah Lawson, Associate Director of the Virginia Center for the Book, a program of Virginia Humanities. Thanks for joining us. A couple notes before we begin. Please share your questions for the authors using the Q&A tab on Zoom. Also, this event has optional closed captioning, which you can turn on and customize at any time with the tab at the bottom of your window. If you haven't already read today's books, we hope you will. For details about how to buy them from a local bookseller, visit vabook.org, where you can also explore the schedule of upcoming programs and watch past events. While you're there, please consider making a donation to support the festival's ongoing work at vabook.org/give. Today, we appreciate the support of our community partners for this event, Dairy Market and the UVA LGBT Committee for Faculty and Staff. Thanks also to our bookseller for this event, Fountain Bookstore in Richmond, Virginia. Now, I'm very pleased to introduce our speakers. Ryka Aoki, author of Light from Uncommon Stars, is a poet, composer, teacher, and novelist whose books include two Lambda Literary Award finalists, Seasonal Velocities and Why Dust Shall Never Settle Upon This Soul. Micaiah Johnson, author of The Space Between Worlds, was raised in California's Mojave Desert. She holds a BA in creative writing and an MFA in fiction, and currently studies American literature at Vanderbilt, where she focuses on critical race theory and automatons. And Lincoln Michel, author of The Body Scout, has had his fiction appear in the Paris Review, Granta, and elsewhere. He is also the author of the story collection Upright Beasts, and the co-editor of the anthologies Tiny Nightmares and Tiny Crimes. And our moderator, Emma Ito, is the director of education at Virginia Humanities. Thank you all so much for being here. Emma, take it away.
Thank you so much, Sarah, and thank you to the Festival of the Book today and these wonderful authors that I'm here with. I'm gonna jump in right to it and ask you to tell us a little bit about your book for those who haven't read. And if you're out there and you haven't read them, I highly recommend, I have to say that you have to read these books. Literally all three of these books got me out of a reading slump. So like super grateful. So if you guys could tell us a little bit about your book, and if you want to do a short reading, this would be a great time to do it. Let's kick it off with you, Ryka.
Hi, everybody. Thanks for inviting me. My name is Ryka Aoki, and my book is Light from Uncommon Stars, and it was released last September by Tor, and they've been amazing. This book is, I've been published in small presses. This is my first book published by a major press, and it is set in the San Gabriel Valley, where I grew up, where there's a huge amount of racial intersection and cultural intersection, a lot of economic disparity. But because everything is accessible by well-paved roads, you get some interesting mixing. What I wanted to do, so the city sort of mashes up a little bit. And this is also a book that is a little bit mashed up. We have a cursed violinist, a trans runaway, a Vietnamese space alien starship captain who is fleeing the galactic empire by opening up a donut shop. And what I wanted to show here with this book, and what I hope you'll get if you read this, is I wanted to show how alternate conceptions of family and existence and humanity can end up writing a story that can still affect us on a very deep and emotional level. You know, and by doing so, wanted to show the validity of our chosen social structures, that they're just as real. And I'm transgender, and I get to be just as real too. So anyway, thank you.
Thank you, Ryka. Micaiah, why don't you tell us a little bit about your book?
Absolutely, and just this odd twist of fate. My book is also about like the kind of less talked about part of Southern California, though I'm not as honest as Ryka. I don't name the high desert, but if you've ever been there, you will know what a hack I am, and you'll just be like, wait, Ashtown is just Oro Grande, what's this? But it's very much that, about the way that geography can kind of dictate existence in so many ways and the difficulty of traversing those spaces. Of course, this is, you know, speculative fiction, so I dial that up to 13. So it's about traversing the multiverse, but it truly is this, that the kind of invisible barriers that we all face, like kind of traversing. So my main character has both done economic traversing and trying to do what we kids in the high desert always thought of as like going down the hill and going to LA, but she's made it to a more successful city, but that's also, it's almost more difficult to travel through multiverses and her job, which is her job, than it is to kind of travel through these kind of classed and raced spaces, which again, Southern California is such a great subject for that because it is, as you say, so diverse and all of these millions of worlds are always bumping up against each other. And yeah, what up Fontana, San Gabriel Valley, yes.
Right on.
One day I'm gonna get good at this blurb part, but it's not gonna be today. Sorry, everyone.
Let's hear it for Fontana.
As somebody in the HD, I have to go, IE, boo, no, HD for life. We have to knife fight later. It's a whole thing.
Thank you. All right, Lincoln. So we're switching up settings a little bit. So how about you tell us about your book?
Yeah. And also, I'm very, very happy to be here. I grew up in Charlottesville. So even though I'm zooming in from Brooklyn, it's nice to be digitally home. Yeah, my book is called The Body Scout. It takes place in a future New York City, which is kind of dealing with climate change and pandemics and healthcare inequality. So maybe not that unlike in the current moment, but it also takes place in a future in which, the main character is an out-of-date cyborg who works for a kind of future baseball league where he scouts scientists instead of players because the baseball teams are run by biotech and pharmaceutical companies. I would say it's kind of like a cyberpunk book with the cyber part being replaced with the body, which is to say it's about kind of body modification, medical inequality, and questions like that, but also has some revived Neanderthals and philosophical scientists and genetically modified CEOs and lots of other weird fun stuff, hopefully.
This is great. I'm already like skipping forward to questions because I'm like, let's talk about capitalism and corporations. But okay, let me back up a little bit. And actually ask you guys what the seeds of the inspiration were for your characters. And maybe that has to do with those larger themes. Ryka, do you want to start us off?
Sure. So a couple of things that are going on. The first one is I grew up, I think many people who end up writing speculative science fiction have the experience of being a misfit, about being an outsider in some cases. And science fiction was something that, and you know, gravitated toward watching the reruns of the original Star Trek. My formative years happened in the dead period between the original Star Trek and Next Generation, you know, where you could only watch reruns and, you know, and so, but I was watching and, you know, during that period of time, the world got quiet. You know, there wasn't so much crazy. I could like dream and focus. And when my emotions were going a mile a minute, there was Mr. Spock talking about logic. And there was this way to do things. And there was, you know, Mr. Sulu, which, wow, an Asian, that's kind of cool. And Uhura. And, you know, there was this beautiful feeling of inclusion until you realized that, you know, who was sitting in the captain's chair all the time. And to the point where when Captain Kirk was disabled, they had to bring this Lieutenant Kyle guy, you know, to like sit there just so he could be the figurehead. And later, as I became more cognizant of racial and, you know, cultural overtones, realized that it wasn't seen as realistic to have Captain Uhura or Captain Sulu, especially back then. And so I wanted, when I had the chance, when I got my chance at writing a science fiction novel, I would open up space to my family. I would open up space to people that looked like me and that I love. You know, and the other thing, just before, you know, the other thing too is the whole, what I loved about a starship was that it was a chosen, it was chosen by Starfleet, you were assigned, but this idea of a chosen family and what a beautiful metaphor it was for being queer. Here we are thrown in this place and we're traveling through this God knows what, and we don't know who we're going to meet at our hostel, so we better band together. You know, you all form the away team, go to Cracker Barrel, you know, that kind of thing. And so, that's what I wanted to do. I wanted to show just how queer narratives and narratives from people of color augment the community and add to the community and give people something more to read. So a lot of, it was a proof of concept, and it was a hope. It was a ship in the bottle, and I'm so glad that it reached some readers.
Thank you, Ryka. My little bisexual Japanese American heart was very excited.
Yokata, ureshi.
So, Micaiah, what about you? What were some seeds of inspiration? You also have a queer Japanese character in your books.
Yes, I do. I feel like I'm just hopping off of Ryka for every single answer, because I also was kind of inspired by an antagonistic relationship to Captain Kirk and the Captain Kirk-like stories where, you know, the very advanced civilization with all of, you know, the baggage those words entail go out into the desert and, you know, find themselves or encounter this like odd red planet. And the high desert of California is actually one of the areas that Star Trek would pretend was Mars. And so I really liked the idea of somebody from those places going into the city and studying them as if they are the odd, strange lives. Like, they all dress this way. It's super weird. They never spit. Like, it's this, and like kind of making that study of the people who believe they're only studying others. And I really enjoyed the idea of turning that mirror. I will say I began writing this book in October 2016, which is a hell of a time to write a book about movement. So I do not, again, I do not know if I would have had this huge wall and this idea if there was not that overwhelming conversation of like travel bans and border walls were so in the air immediately after I started this, that I think movement and geography became explicated in the power that they hold and the power they represent. I think I've always been like kind of a character driven one, and I hadn't thought too much about landscape. And then that just kind of, it's a moment where you could no longer ignore the power implicit in geographies and space and movement and all of those kinds of categories. And so I think that that absolutely was a seed that I had not intended, and then just kind of went through the ether. And of course, I just want to be very upfront. I sound super competent right now, but at no point was I like, you know what I'm hearing a lot of? This thing, I'm going to write about it. It's more just like that osmosis. And then looking back, you can say, oh, I bet that's where that all came from. But I'm not as aware as I wish I were in my creative process. There's just this like stranger in the back of my head who vomits things out. And thankfully, sometimes they're good things. And also, Lincoln, please, please, you said it's like steampunk, but replace like steam with body. Please, please patent body punk, because I will begin using that. And I will absolutely cite you.
Well, there is the term biopunk, which certainly far predates me. So I don't want anyone to give me any angry.
That's why you say body, TM.
Yeah. Yeah, well, that, I mean, what you just said was pretty much my major, I don't know, I guess starting seed point for myself, which was more cyberpunk than steampunk. But like, I love cyberpunk books, you know, I love that kind of anti-corporate punk rock, you know, screw the system vibe that a lot of those books have, but also find myself, despite being a completely, totally too much online person who's on Twitter all the time, I find myself kind of bored with virtual reality at this point. And when I'm looking at, you know, this came after my book, but Facebook's metaverse, and it's like a bunch of Playmobil looking characters writing on chalkboards and office meetings. I don't know, there's great stuff in that realm, but it wasn't what I wanted to do. So I wanted to try to have that kind of cyberpunk vibe, but focused on the body and the kind of future of biotech and cybernetics and all of these different things coming down the line. In terms of the characters, I do think because of that, I wanted to create a very diverse cast of characters that are also diverse in their reactions to this future. Because one thing that I don't, like a slight pet peeve of mine in some science fiction is when there's a kind of new technology and it's implemented universally with universal acceptance from everyone, which is not really how things go in the real world in my experience. So a lot of the kind of conceits from the book came from trying to think of different individual and ideological reactions to a future in which, you know, capitalism becomes even more hyper-capitalist and the inequality between the physical bodies and healthcare widens, but also you have these new emergent technologies that are, you know, already on the horizon now.
Yeah, that's so interesting, Lincoln, because all three of your books, but Lincoln, yours in particular, made me think of especially like corporations and capitalism in that sense. So I guess my next question for all three of you would be kind of, how do you explore some of these large themes that affect us in our everyday lives, like capitalism and greed and corporations, right? Climate change. How do you do that in your books or just in sci-fi in general? Lincoln, do you want to start us off?
Sure, yeah. Well, for my book, it was definitely, you know, the scenes of it. I grew up like a real kid who was into punk rock. And, you know, I always like that kind of, you know, screw the corporation kind of attitude. So I feel like that's in there pretty bluntly. In terms of how I tried to depict it, I would call my book something of a satire and also written in a somewhat expressionist mode is maybe how I would frame it. But a lot of the aspects of the book take our reality, especially contemporary New York City, and hyperbolize it and kind of extrapolate it a bit into the future. So to pick a random example, my main character, Kobo, lives in these kind of underground apartment buildings that are called like subterranean subsidized apartment buildings or something like that. And in New York City, in real life, they stopped this recently, but for a while we had this thing in which new apartment buildings that went up would get you know, they would have areas of the apartment buildings that were designated for affordable housing, and they would give a separate door for those people. It was called the poor door, so that the, you know, the wealthier residents didn't even have to see the people who, you know, were getting subsidized housing. So a lot of the elements of the book were kind of like that. Take something from today and kind of extrapolate it through a science fiction lens to hopefully, you know, make us better see what's happening in the real world today.
Micaiah, Ryka, any thoughts on this?
So, go ahead.
Just Lincoln, as you were talking, I was thinking about this idea of hyperbole and how much more difficult it's becoming to achieve. I thought I was likewise hyperbolic in my treatment of capitalism. I was like, it's pretty on the nose. Like, I've got this super billionaire who wears the same clothes every day, and he's going to try and colonize multiverse. And that's wild, you guys. And this was, of course, my book came out just before we had three billionaires do a space race in the middle of a global pandemic, right? So I did not go hard enough. And so similarly, like what you said really interested me, Lincoln, about kind of taking little elements of today. Because I think when we write, and particularly writing speculative fiction, we make these conscious choices of what we don't want to deal with and what we are going to deal with. And I really envy people who can envision these things, you know, outside of the framework of capitalism and poverty and all of those things. I'm not one of those people. I'm very like stuck in the Frederick Jameson model. It's easier to imagine the end of the world than to imagine the end of capitalism. But I did make those choices somewhat. Like, I didn't want homophobia to be a huge thing that had to happen in Ashdown. I wanted there to be just a non-expectation of straightness or heterosexuality. But again, capitalism is that inescapable thing, and we can try to like hyperbolize it, but the seeds are still so present in our lives that I feel like we're all like on a ticking clock of when this wild thing that we imagined happening just kind of becomes the dark reality. And that's very pessimistic. That's such a bummer to say. There are all kinds of possibilities for the future, and don't give up hope, but it is that thing where we're writing in our worst case scenarios. And unfortunately, sometimes our speculative fiction stops being so speculative. And that's always the kind of shadow that we're writing out of.
Oh, I was only going to say, as someone with a very near future book, several things happened like that, where I was like, oh, this will be ridiculous, and then it happened.
Lincoln, so when I was listening to you talking about the idea of punk hacking and things like that, you know, hacking works in a lot of different ways. And I think that sometimes what we can do is it's like my grandma hacks when she is just trying to figure out how to use the phone, and she like does something weird with recipes. And so what I wanted to do is I wanted to double down on family dynamic and tradition and let grandma hack for a while, let auntie hack and see what they can come up with. So for example, you use the ship's replicators, which is institution, galactic empire, and you make donuts. And you know, it's like, I'm going to hack the system. I'm going to take this thing that was designed to do God knows what, to God knows what those people are, you know, and like, you know, blow up planets and things. And we're going to make donuts. And so we make the donuts. The donuts don't want to spoil too much, but it's not a great product, which becomes, I think, in some ways, a criticism on this idea of dehumanizing or de-individualizing the lived experience. And, you know, And then a little bit more seriously, I have a character with a very Faustian trope where there's somebody with a cursed violin, and you think this is really horrible until you realize that, and even she realizes that it's nothing compared to the everyday institutional and individual aggressions that are happening to, you know, her charge, the Katrina, who is a trans runaway. And so the question is hell, you know, we think hell is really bad, but what are we doing to ourselves? Who needs hell when we have parents that disown their children? So what I wanted to really do is examine, as you were saying, Emma, the institutional forces that confront us by squeezing it down to the individual level and having the individual's experience of these absurd situations try to illuminate the reader and take them through that way. So,
and I feel like I could listen to you guys talk about this all day. So let me try and go along the questions. Also, shout out, I'm going to back up a little bit to Rika's food. Because don't read Rika's book if you're hungry, because the food descriptions are very good. Speaking of donuts, now I want to do it. okay, so I of course, like, don't want to talk about capitalism and greed and corporation without also talking about healing and resistance, which mm-hmm. all three of your characters have a lot of healing and resistance. So I kind of wanted to hear you guys talk a little bit about that, and also if you felt like you experienced any healing as a writer, like writing through some of this. Ryka, why don't you start us off?
Sure. So I think I just want to, we talk about healing and we talk about resistance. And I think in my community, in my trans community, we're always fighting. And to be honest, I can't see an end to it. We're going to be fighting for trans acceptance and the rights will be taken away. And there's all this nonsense that's going on right now in Idaho and in Texas. And it's just, don't. Thank you. But the idea of all or nothing, that we have to win or we lose. What I wanted to do in this book is I wanted to understand that you're forgiven for occasionally failing. You are forgiven for not being a saint. You are forgiven for effing up sometimes, because I want to offer more than victory. I want to, because I don't really believe right now as a trans person in victory, I wanted to give respite. And I wanted to give permission to relax a little bit, to forgive yourself and to go have a donut or go have Hainan chicken and something like that. The other thing now personally with healing was the weirdest thing that happened. I was writing this story and one of my characters is a cybernetic. Her name is Shirley and she's a program, you know, think the emergency doctor on Voyager. Except written better, but anyway, as I was writing this, it was all about trans reality and not being valid. Are you a real person? Are you a real woman? Mm-hmm. But that reality just hit me in a very, very deep way. And then I remembered there's a lot of ways to be invalidated. And my mother used to tell me that it was a good thing that they went to the beach that day, because otherwise she wouldn't have overexerted herself and miscarried and I would never have been born. So I've always been growing up feeling like the replacement child. And I was thinking about this and going, I don't usually confront this. And I was getting really emotional and thinking, maybe stories can help people confront things that, you know, that are, there's so many ways we don't feel valid. And so maybe we in perversely, you know, the very out not belonging of transness can also serve as a catalyst for other people to examine and maybe come to peace with feelings of not really being who people think you should properly be.
Thank you, Ryka. Mm-hmm. Lincoln or Micaiah, did you guys want to talk about healing and resistance?
Yeah, Micaiah, do you want to go?
First, all good.
Well, yeah, I mean, this is a great question. And Ryka, that was very beautifully said. I think, on one level, I think my book is, you know, sometimes called like dystopian, and it definitely takes place in, as I said, a kind of hyperbolized future, and which is like, what if we go down the path we're going down now? And I did want to have some kind of, at least some amount of hope in the book, I guess, is something to say, which I think is important. I love that, you know, that Frederick Jameson quote that Micaiah said of, it's easier to imagine the end of the world than it is to imagine the end of capitalism. I also remember this very moving speech that maybe everyone here saw of by Ursula K. Le Guin when she won the kind of Lifetime Achievement Award at the National Book Awards. And she talked about how writers of the imagination really need to imagine a future, imagine different futures for us. And I wouldn't say my book quite goes there because it's still kind of in the near future where we're kind of screwed. But I did hope that there is a sense of kind of individual hope for the characters and a little bit of healing for them at least.
Yeah, Lincoln, I feel like for healing for yours, I thought a lot about the grief and trauma of losing someone. And so like, I see that through the individual journey, much appreciated. Micaiah, what about you?
Yeah, I have very complicated, I think, feelings about healing and resistance because there are ways in which healing and taking care of yourself and being whole when you live in a marginalized body is its own act of resistance. But for me, when I think about resistance as kind of activism or direct action activism, that must be completely separate from healing, right? For me, that must be separate. You must be healed to engage in that work, but your restorative practices are almost always separate from that. For me, to keep me sane while I'm going out there and doing those things. And so for me, like the idea that I wanted to convey, and this is one of those books in which I learned something from my character, which was that we so often, and I think this is, you know, the kind of Western idea of exceptionalism, we so often envision activism as someone is going to stand up and we will know their name and they will have a bullhorn. And that is the vision that we have of resistance is the singular. And I really wanted the act, the path to resistance to be returning to your community and it being that the way you function in community and how you uphold your community is actually that really material kind of act of resistance. It's like we want our Fred Hamptons, but remember that like the Black Panther Party fed and offered daycare and did all of these things as well. Like it was absolutely always about that kind of group thing, absolutely. And I think that gets lost because of our love of that, except our love of that exceptionalist narrative, right? We love geniuses, we love bright shining lights. And so for me, like that's kind of what I wanted it to be, where it's like she actually discovers her path to resistance by returning to community. And as far as healing, I was very intentional about two things that I wanted to be in the book, which was I wanted, in the aftermath of trauma, I wanted there to be a kind of traditional therapy, destigmatized therapy scene. So it's just like, yeah, she absolutely like goes to a therapist in the wake of this kind of devastating event that happens. So it's a really hard book not to spoil. I'm so sorry, I'm trying. But then also to acknowledge that while therapy is important to so many people's healings, and please like do that, there are limitations to what therapy can achieve in the face of structural injustice. And so she must also then return to kind of cultural norms and cultural rituals to restore herself with people who can only understand because they come from her place. And it's a practice that's much more about touch and incense and ritual and that kind of thing outside of kind of traditional therapy settings, which are still kind of in the medical industrial complex and subject to all of those injustices. And so it's kind of that thing where it's like, go to therapy is not a full sentence. And I wanted to have both aspects of care because I feel like too often it's like therapy is terrible. Instead, just like have these crystals, or therapy is great, do away with everything else. And instead, I wanted to show that like you can have your balance for whatever kind of put together care means for you. But by no means is it you should be relying solely on any therapeutic practice and wondering why that's not fixing the offshoots of systemic injustice, right? It can't do that work. Like that work has to also come from somewhere else. And so that was kind of something that was very intentional about as a positive view of therapy, but not discounting the fact that there are other practices that are also kind of necessary for that journey of healing. And those so often come from community and from others.
Thank you so much for that answer. Because I really just love everything that you said. And it makes me think so much of like, yeah, like all three of your books is like your chosen family, right? And your families mm-hmm. and your community and like community care. So I love that. Thank you so much. So in thinking of all of this in this whole conversation, I'm really interested in like, would you guys hang out with your characters and would you like be in that world if you could? Because all three of you have these different, well, in some ways, right? In some ways, these different worlds. So what would you hang out with your characters? Micaiah, what about you?
I would pay any amount of money to have a house, like the house, to hang out with Exley for 1 hour. I would bankrupt myself. Like, please let me hang out with them and just like be in that space, which, you know, has like great decor and amazing music and the drinks are strong. Like, I would pay good money. Kara, like, Kara's going through some stuff. I don't know. That seems like a lot of work to be Kara's friend, but I would absolutely hang out with Exley and just learn how to do fan work. It'd be great.
Ryka, what about you?
Well, I think I already do. I mean, this is the, I still carry magical realism through all of my work. And I always, so my hometown is Alhambra and San Gabriel. The San Gabriel and Alhambra that I wrote about and Rosemead and Monterey Park, they don't exactly line up cartographically with what you know, the physical world. And I did that on purpose, because when you write a book and there's a potential for readers to come in to look at the book and maybe want to explore the area, you don't want to strip mine grandma's house. You want to make sure that certain, I don't have the right to say, hey, this is her address, come. You know, I know for some people it's good for business, but I also know some of the horrors that gentrification can cause. So, you know, I've turned it into a bit of a puzzle. The funny thing is though that when I drive through San Gabriel now, I think, wait, is that supposed to be there, or was that just in my book when it doesn't completely line up? All's to say, one of the things I wanted to do with this book is really blunt that transition between the world of the book and the world we live in now, because I want readers to see that maybe there might be a starship underneath this donut shop. Maybe that violinist does descend from this amazing family. Maybe there are these things going on, because I don't think I still get asked if I speak English. Yeah, and you look at me and you might make assumptions, but there's so much more going on here. And it might not necessarily literally be you came from across the galaxy, but it's pretty damn close, and in some ways better. So part of why I wanted to write this book was to make it so it could be plausibly part of the world you're going to still be in when the Zoom conversation concludes, is that you might give yourself a chance to see the magic in the people you see every day.
I love that. Lincoln, what about you? Would you hang out with your characters?
Yeah, I mean, you know, I think it's hard not to write characters, even the kind of villains that you don't like to some degree. You know, so I would maybe I wouldn't want to be best friends with them for a long period of time. Would I want to like meet them all? Yeah, that seems nice. In terms of the future, you know, my book it's not really pegged in time, but maybe a kind of 50 years in the future kind of thing. And you know, I don't think that science fiction, or certainly my science fiction, is trying to be predictive or prophetic in any way. But I do think that some of the things that I wrote about that I think are things that I think are coming down the line. So, you know, Lord willing, I'll be in that world, and we'll all be in that world in a couple decades, perhaps. Whether that's a good or bad thing, I don't know.
Yeah, Lincoln, I particularly was thinking of like pharmaceutical companies like running the future, which is a little terrifying. So I have some crafty questions, and Common House Book Club, I do see your Q&A, so we will have some time. I'm going to leave the last 10 minutes or so, so we're going to answer your question, I promise. But I do have some crafty questions, and I'm really curious how you guys kind of get in the right headspace, to write, because everyone's different the way they approach writing. Micaiah, how about you start us off?
You saw me do raccoon hands when you said crafty questions. I got so excited. Yes, I'm going to just say that, just because craft, I'm so often imagining like potential and new and already writers, right, listening. I do want to say that I think that some of the advice that we get is smart from a marketing standpoint, but not smart from a creative standpoint. So often we're told, read the genre you want to publish it and know it in and out, and that's what you should do, which is great for marketing and knowing your comps and things like that when you query. However, in my experience, to actually produce and to get into that mindset, the Tolkien calls it the ooze, right? We all write from this ooze, and you can see, but that ooze is filled up by everything you read, but also everything you watch, listen to, every conversation at a bar, every experience that you have. So I actually have the opposite of that kind of genre-based advice, where don't do that, like read everything. Like for me, if I'm not reading poetry and nonfiction, then I don't have epigraphs, right? Then I don't have feelings. And everything that you read in every single genre has a different strength. So if you want to know about foreshadowing, read mystery. If you want snappy dialogue, read romance. If you want visceral, very tangible descriptions, get your horror read on. And if you, you know, and there's no end to what you can learn from like high fantasy about world building and magic systems and inventing your own currency, like all kinds of things. And of course, for those beautiful details that make the world interesting and, you know, kind of collapsible into moments, you've got to like sometimes, you know, diverge into nonfiction and see these kind of interesting things that make up our world. And when I say diverge into nonfiction, I do sometimes mean reading, like I've got this giant book propping up here, Carl Safina's What Animals Think and Feel, but also like nonfiction is the people around you and talking to them about their stories and having that all goes into the ooze. And then for me, that is more important than just being able to replicate the conventions of your genre. Absolutely. So you will be expected to be familiar with the big names in your field and your genre and all of those things. But please, for the sake of your craft, fill that ooze with as many diverse references as possible.
Mm-hmm. Lincoln, what about you?
Well, I strongly agree with everything that was just said. I very much consider myself a genre omnivore. I try to read everything. And also, yeah, it's completely true that, you know, your writing is pulled from everything. You know, there's little bits and moments in my book that come from video games or TV shows or conversations with friends. Yeah, it's all it becomes a big soup in your brain. In terms of like getting into a headspace, I don't have the biggest problem with that per se. I think my biggest problem is that I need like time. And so like giving myself time and stealing every snippet of time that I have, you know, writing notes on the subway when I'm going to work and forcing myself to go off of the computer and off of the cell phone and go sit in a park and read my manuscript and all those kind of things are kind of my biggest struggle in terms of getting in the headspace.
What about you, Ryka?
I think that Micaiah and Lincoln really said it well, just to sort of piggyback off of both of them. And especially going to come from a standpoint of queer writers of color, a lot of times we have been conditioned to think that our voice is not important. And other people, we tend to, especially I know in the trans community, there's so much generosity of people giving of their own to other people. And sometimes you have to give to your story and you have to give to your readers and you have to be a guardian of your own work. So, you know, as Lincoln was saying, it's very, very important, you know, to have that space where you feel entitled to be writing on the subway instead of, you know, checking in on your friends to make sure they're okay. And sometimes that can be really difficult, but I will tell you, if you're coming from that space, we need your stories. Believe in yourself. I'm interested in reading them. And these are voices and stories that need to be heard. So specifically out to people who are writers of color, queer writers, people, you know, people who feel that they're not represented. Your stories are hecka important, and we need you to be a little, we need you to I can't say need. Selfish. You do what you want. Yeah, I can't ask you to do that, but certainly be nice if you saw how beautiful you were.
I really love that so much. And I'm actually going to ask the Common House question because I think it's kind of in the thread of this conversation. The Common House Book Club, they said this question is for Micaiah, but may apply to other books and authors as well. One theme that came up in our book club discussions is imposter syndrome. And as someone who is all too familiar with these feelings, does this book reflect your own, given your upbringing and when writing what I believe is your first novel? And this was to Micaiah, but I think it can go to all of you guys. So Micaiah, what do you think?
I mean, my goodness, I'm an academic. That's my job. I was grading before this Zoom started. I'll be grading as soon as this Zoom ends. And I don't think there is any, and this is just coming from, you know, of course I feel this way, but it's like, there is an imposter syndrome like no other being first gen Black academia. And I, as one of those things where, again, you don't realize it going back. So I, of course, scholarship kid here, I was able to go into an MFA because it was funded. And I went from Southern California in the middle of nowhere to like a built up Northeastern city with all these preconceptions about, you know, oh, there's, it's so much more progressive. It's all of these things. And then just to learn the different flavors of racism and different flavors of kind of being put down that just come with better vocabularies, essentially, you know, and just you really do have that. And so I did not recognize that so much of that was in the book that came from that experience of existing in an institution that, you know, doesn't want you there. Like the people that we constantly hold up, like I'm doing work on Hannah Arendt. Hannah Arendt didn't believe there could be Black scholars. And so like, these are things that you have to live side by side with every day in this pursuit of knowledge. And you are talking yourself into it all the time as you're doing it. And so absolutely, I think imposter syndrome is kind of this inescapable thing, you know? And for me, I don't know if I've ever talked myself fully out of it. I'm a pandemic debut, and I'm a pre-vaccine pandemic debut, which means I've never given a reading in public, with the exception of I was doing the sit-in protest and I did like a kind of a reading there, but it wasn't, you know, I've never had people come and read. So this all feels fake. This all feels like maybe there are people watching, maybe this is all an elaborate joke my agent is pulling on me. So I wish I could say like, got you, imposter syndrome is something, but here are my steps to curing it. But truly, my imposter syndrome is telling me that I do not have that answer. And I absolutely live within it. The only thing that I've really enjoyed is if you feel out of place in an institution, if you feel like you don't belong, good. The phrase that I like the best is grit in the machine. Better be a grit in the machine than a gear. And so it's like if all of that out of placeness and that like you're going against things, you don't need to fight it. Just see that as power, see that standing outness. Like I often use the term of trying to be disruptive in the undercommons of the university. And so it's like, yeah, I'm an imposter. Good, because this is a white supremacist institution. If I felt at home here, something would be wrong with my mindset. So just instead of, I try to like recalibrate this idea of being ill fit to instead disruption, because I don't know, I was raised wrong. I like to fight. And I like the idea of just like being nefarious versus like kind of the inherent victimization that feels implicit in the imposter syndrome. So for me, that feeling doesn't go away because you are in a machine that's trying to eat you. As Amiri Baraka says, you're in the mouth of a man that hates you, but at least make him choke. You know, you don't want to taste good. So let that imposter syndrome ferment into something more like acid, I guess, and more like disruption, because you're not meant to feel at home in these places often. And that feeling at home will never come because it's not meant to, and just make it power.
Awesome. So just kind of picking up beyond that. Thank you, Micaiah. It really resonates what you just said with me. It was, and I also, my book came out in September and I just had my first public reading just last week. I was on a boat and I had a public reading and I really can't wait for you to have your public signing. I think you're really going to enjoy it. I signed books for 2.5 hours and I was just signing, saying thank you. I saw everybody's queer kid on their cell phone, and you know, and it was and to hear just face to face. And I know, you know, Zoom is wonderful, and it's beautifully, it makes this accessible to people who might not be able to hit, some of these spaces are not accessible. So I'm really grateful for that. But my own selfish thing is it's nice to run and talk to people face to face. And it was rewarding. So when you're first, when you do your first reading and you can start doing that, I just hope it's beautiful. I just wish it's everything for you. You know, the thing is that we, when I first got published, I thought, you know, this is all going to be taken away. I don't know what's going to happen. I signed a 2-book deal. What if this F's up and they stop the second deal? They break the contract. They tell me, go back where you came from. I don't even know where that is, but just wherever you go, that ooze that Micaiah's talking about, just go back to the ooze. And so I was like saying yes to everything. I was on this panel, that panel. I was talking, seeing, can I do more? My agent and my editor told me, slow down, breathe. Yes, everybody here looks white. Get it, breathe anyway. It's a contrast, you know, and you've already, you've already proven yourself. Breathe. And they kept saying, breathe. And realizing that this game is not a sprint. It's a long-term thing that we, and then just trying to imagine, not, I have a hard time talking about me this way, but I think it's easier for me to talk to another woman of color. So, you know, Micaiah here, it's like, we don't need martyrs. We need mentors. We need mm-hmm. you in for the long haul. We want to grow old and wise with you. So be kind to yourself. And I just can't wait for your reading to really just feed your soul.
You make me cry in public. I will never forgive you, Ryka. How dare you? Don't look at me.
Thank you guys. So I'm going to backtrack a little bit because
Lincoln get a chance to answer that?
Oh, Lincoln, sorry. Go ahead. Lincoln,
that's the true imposter. I mean, now we know.
Yeah, Lincoln. I'm sorry, Lincoln.
No. I mean, I think everything that was said is very beautiful and very true. I think it's, you know, there's a fun, for like people who are in the audience who are writers or aspiring writers, I think probably all three of us can confirm that the imposter syndrome kind of never goes away, or it doesn't seem to. And obviously it's, you know, can be much worse for people who are marginalized in ways that I'm not. But I do, you know, I still feel somewhat like an imposter when I come from kind of more, you know, I have an MFA too, like Micaiah, mm-hmm. and come from a kind of literary fiction background without getting into the problems of that terminology. Yeah. And when I was writing this book, I felt like I had to teach myself plot from scratch. I'd never really learned how to plot something. I definitely felt like very much an imposter in science fiction, and thought no one would, you know, in that community would take me seriously. And, you know, I don't know what else there is to say except persevere and know that it's kind of a very common feeling.
Thank you, Lincoln. And thank you, Ryka, for catching me on that. So I actually want to backtrack a little bit because one of you guys mentioned video games earlier, and I feel like I have to bring up video games and also sports, because Lincoln, like, there's so much baseball in yours. So I really wanted to ask, like, what kind of other media may have, like, put some inspiration other than literary media? And Lincoln, you can start us out.
Yeah, well, yeah, there were definitely some video game inspiration in my book. When I was a young kid, I had, you know, an NES, and this game that we used to go rent video games from Blockbuster or something, right? For the young people in the audience, like, what's a Blockbuster? Mm-hmm. What's a rental? Anyway, but I would always rent this game called Base Wars, which was about these robots playing baseball, and you could, like, get to first base, and if they, you know, had you out, you could fight, the robots would fight and kill each other or ruin each other. So that was kind of something in my mind. I mean, another video game inspiration for me was that there was a game I quite liked when I was young called Syndicate Wars, which was a total cyberpunk game that was about, like, these massive cyberpunk companies that were putting chips in people's brains and stuff. And none of that stuff is really in my book, but there was this thing in which you worked for these kind of dystopian corporations in the game. And some of the side quests would involve you kidnapping scientists. And for some reason, that always stuck with me. And so in my book, when I created this kind of futuristic scout character, he's scouting scientists instead of scouting players, which is maybe just an example of how you can take something from a very different medium and turn it into a totally different idea. But I think, like Micaiah was saying before, and I think all writers I know, you know, we're like little birds flying around looking for shiny things on the ground and stealing them to take back to our nests. And you can steal from any and everywhere.
Mm-hmm. Yes. We have such strong feelings about video games. Like, my partner works in the field of video games and accessibility. So I've really begun looking at these things far more differently than I ever have, because I've always played games, but I haven't, like, looked at them in this way that I'm now being so rewarded by doing. But then that you realize you actually always have been. I mean, how much about narrative did I learn from playing BioShock? And I'm the youngest, and I'm aggressively the youngest of many sisters and many female cousins. And so when I was giving my spiel about this genre can teach you this, there's so much about horror games that teach you how to make your player feel safe through peril, right? How to make your, like, what you, like, those save points, those moments of breath In these things where you want the stakes to still be intense, but you need them to continue without, you know, dissolving into panic and fear. And video games have figured out how breathing space works. And for me, I'm a coward. So my sisters would play Silent Hill and I would lay on the couch and watch and cover half my face, depending on where Pyramid Head was. But that was our thing. We played every horror game. And that is something that truly, again, like, I'm not going to force anybody to play all the Silent Hill games. They're hard to get / emulate, but that kind of thing of the care that video game designers have to take to think, like, we think about our readers certainly, but we're not thinking about players and like, what is the accessibility of the interface and when will they need a break? And all of those kinds of active and explicit discussions in video game design, I think, do well to be applied to the literary arts, where we're kind of more just like, and we're vibing and there's narrative and the Freytag pyramid, but instead it's so person first as to like, our characters will have, like, our players will have a heart attack if we don't have a break here. Where's our safe room? Like, that kind of awareness of pacing with built-in stakes as opposed to just interest is something that we can all, I think, learn from. And of course, video games are just super, super fun and soothing. And sometimes it's great to play Edith Finch and think a lot about the opportunities and how death can be bliss. But it's also fun to play Stardew Valley and be like, how much money can I get for an ancient wine, please? You know, all of those things are covered just like with every other artistic genre. And there's no end to what it can give you. I'm very pro video game right now. Sorry.
Yeah, no, this is like making me so happy, because like, now I just want to see like an Alan Wake version of all three of you guys. Like, that's like about a writer. It's like a horror game. Anyway, yeah. Sorry, Ryka.
So, I mean, for me, watching the thing about video games that I really like, and video, to write a video game is still on my to-do list. You know, I want to do this, but you know, I can't go without talking about Undertale. I love Undertale. Yes. And the idea that you can choose your own fate. What blew me away about Undertale was that you didn't have to kill anybody, and that was a route too. And so I think that people in writing games are becoming incredibly visionary, because what writer would say, you know, make friends with everybody, that there's no, how does that even work? But in a video game, there it was. And I just think, as Micaiah was saying, I so admire well-written video games from the point of view of a storyteller. They've just been fantastic. You know, other things that I've done, it's like, you know, the music from, you know, a lot from Legend of Zelda just changed my life. A lot of people who, in the queer community, a lot of people access the queer community through social activism, but there's this whole other group of queers who do it through cyberspace and through social, and through media and through manga. They cosplay. They work. The first time they put on a dress, they might be cosplaying somebody. And I found that just so fascinating, having come, as both Micaiah and Lincoln have, through like an academic MFA program. This was kind of cool. So you know, music, you know, something like Lindsay Sterling has just this amazing following within this fandom, within anime, that we can't explain in tradition, you know, we'd never heard of back when we were in MFA programs. And I'm just really, really loving it. And just a shout out to Violet Evergarden. If you haven't seen that anime, you must, because that's where I stole that balance between poignancy and beauty. I don't think I really caught it all, because Violet Evergarden is amazing, but I think I did okay. I hope. But yeah, we talk about stealing. Yeah, that, you know, we steal, and that was just beautiful. But great question, Emma.
Yeah, gamer had to know.
Yeah. Ryka, have you played If Found?
No, I haven't. You gotta like text. Yeah, okay.
Oh, it's a story of like transness, but it's If Found, and the game is played by erasing letters of a journal and revealing.
Oh my gosh,
like,
how cool is that? I'm gonna look it up. Okay, cool. And otherwise, email me back channel. Okay, cool.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Awesome.
We're gonna do things.
All right.
Instead of book links, we're like having these poor folks like scramble for video game links. Sorry, Festival of the Books folks. Also, I just wanted to put in, we have, it's 12:54, which is wild. I feel like it just flew by. And I, like I said, I know I could talk to you three like for a long time. So I really, really appreciate you guys and all your great thoughts here. We probably do have time. If anyone has any questions for the chat, we probably have time for like one. So I'll give it like a second to see if any questions come in. If not, then, you know, I have a million more questions. So, and you know, while we're waiting, I kind of, oh, here we go. Is there from Leslie, Is there a craft question you always wish people asked you, and what's the answer?
I'm sorry, I'm just jumping in here.
Yeah, yeah, go ahead.
I don't know if there's a craft question I wish people asked me so much as there's a craft question I wish the correct people asked, because I feel like science fiction and fantasy and genre writers constantly ask me about world building. And I kind of wish literary authors were more cognizant of world building themselves, because I think so often when we're inventing monetary systems and naming new cultures and inventing languages, we know we're world building, but I don't think literary authors are aware that by what they include, they are also world building, and there are ethics and skill involved in that. And they often, they hide behind reality, I think, is like, well, yeah, my world is X because it represents this, but it's like, you are still the curator and you are still choosing those things. So I kind of just, this is, not a great answer to that question, but I do wish that authors who were not genre had that same awareness and sophistication of the ethics and responsibility when you are creating a world, even if it's New York City, even if it's, even if it's your family's living room, you are responsible to the citizens in that place and the citizens you are inviting into that place. And what you choose to include is a political decision. And those rooms are curated by you. And you can say, well, this is what it is. It's like, no, but that's what you see, and be aware that your subject position dictates what you think is there. And kind of that's one of my minor pet peeves is literary, as coming from an MFA, right? They don't think about plot as much as genre fiction writers, but they also don't think about world building as intentional as it is. They think they're just writing it as it is, when really they're curating the whole time, just unaware. Mm-hmm.
I want to toss something out just also, just in terms of craft, a shout out to sensitivity readers. A lot of times people come in from, as you were saying, coming in from an MFA program, Lit Fic, it's like, right? But sensitivity readers are amazing, because we cannot cover one of the beautiful and I think really practical things we learn writing science fiction fantasy is suddenly my readership has just increased by about a couple factors of 10, I think. This, it's like my book outsold my last novel before it was released, kind of thing, right? And so you're running into completely different scales. And so you are in the ocean now, and I can check off a lot of oppression things, blah, 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 blah. Yeah, I can check off a lot, but there are things that I can't check off. And working with a good team, that's what they do. And I think that one of the things about craft is be prepared to collaborate with good people. Mm-hmm. Have a great editor, great sensitivity reader. Yes, you own the story, but trust that people are there to kind of polish it for you and help make it better. Back out to sensitivity readers. You hire one and suddenly it's this non-binary, queer, person of color who's your queer, who's your sensitivity reader. Guess what? You've just helped that person make rent. So what I'm saying is also bring in 10 sensitivity readers, because I mean, that helps our community. It takes money from the big press and it gives it to the people that you want to, occasionally maybe have a drink with at the queer bar.
Yes. I just want to jump in and say exactly the same. I'm a similar where it's just like, oh, I've got a lot of bases covered, but I used a sensitivity reader for sex worker rep in my last book. I'm using a disability sensitivity reader for my next book. Like, the crime is not the admitting that you don't know something or that you can't invent certain perspectives. The crime is when you don't admit those things, right? That's when we get into trouble. So just second everything that Ryka just said.
Yeah, I'll third it too. I feel like sometimes that discussion gets caught up in for the people who get, irked about it or something, get caught up on the word sensitivity or something. But for me, it's like, you want to get things right, right? If you're writing about people who aren't like you, you want to make sure you're not totally misrepresenting their kind of, way of thinking. So yeah, I had people read my book for sure.
And it used to be like, nobody wondered when murder mystery writers would just get like shadow detectives or doctors. Yeah. Not a problem if you're doing occupational sensitivity. But if it's actually somebody's identity, suddenly everybody loses their minds.
And you don't want to name your Asian character Cho Chang.
Oh, yeah. Oof.
Oh. Please no. Yeah. Well, we're amazingly already at time. It is 12:59 right
now. Oh my gosh.
For us to wrap
this is so much fun.
It's been so much fun. And Lincoln, Ryka, Micaiah, I have enjoyed talking to you guys so much and listening to your conversations. And thank you so much to all of you that have tuned in at home and that maybe are watching this later. Shout out to you guys. And please buy these books, support these authors. You can, I definitely encourage you guys to buy these from your local bookstores, your local booksellers. There are links in the at virginiabook.org or in the chat. And then you can also explore the rest of the 2022, oh my gosh, we're in 2022. How'd that even happen? 2022 Virginia Festival of the Book schedule, which runs to through March 20th at vabook.org. And there's so many good talks that have been recorded, including this one. So if you wanna watch something you may have missed, it will be up there. So thank you guys so much.
And well, thank you, Emma, for moderating.
It was so fun.
This was great.
Thank you guys, and have a wonderful rest of your day.
Read plenty of books.
Read lots of books. Play some video games.
Awesome. Play video games too. Bye.